Amen. All right, you may all be seated. Well, welcome everyone. It's good to see you all again. Welcome. All right. Hey, I hope all you dads out there had a wonderful Father's Day. I know I did. I feel like this Father's Day was one of the best Father's Day, just only in the level of the presents that I've got. I really feel like this Father's Day, like any other one, this one was just so different because it was more of like a rite of passage in my life. For this one, I got barbecue tools. And I really felt at that point that I've officially become a dad when I got more excited about barbecue tools than I think anyone's got. Oh, wow, we got tongs too. This is gonna flip chicken great. It's gonna be fantastic, you know? And then my daughter, she gave me something and it was like the Armor All Dash cleaner. And I was like, oh, this is gonna be great. I'm gonna clean that dash. And I just realized I hit that age where I graduated into like super dad. Don't be surprised if you start seeing me wear like socks and sandals or like white New Balance shoes and talking about cutting grass or something. Anyways, but if you have your Bibles, let's go ahead and continue through our study as we've been going through it. Let's go ahead and be in Exodus chapter 17 as we are going to do the last half since we started with the first half of it last week. But we looked as last week, there was more trials in the wilderness, go figure. There was more things as they set out on the commandment of the Lord. And truthfully, church, I shared this last week, but the best place that you could ever be in life is setting out at the commandment of the Lord, regardless of what comes against you, regardless of your needs or your wants in that moment, because you've set out when the Lord has sent you, you need to know that it's the safest place than you could possibly be. If you are in the midst of the storm with the Lord, it's better than being safe on the boat, on the shore, right? So it's the best spot that you can be at is with the Lord at the commandment of Him. But I will tell you that when you say, Lord, use me in whatever way you want, you say, Lord, I just want to go where you want to send me, just know that there's a good chance that there's going to be trials along the way, that there's going to be tribulations along the way. What really bothers me a lot of times are these pastors that want to talk about just nothing but prosperity message, that you should never be having any hard times, that everything should be rich and you should be happy. Listen, I will tell you that is not the way a walk with the Lord looks, because the Lord allows you to go through these paths in life, like here where they were thirsty and they were hungry and sometimes they were scared, because He taught them who He was through those times of weakness. And so oftentimes God lets us go through these times of testing and trials in our life to create good things. And a repeating theme that we saw in the desert was this: the children of Israel became thirsty. I don't know about you, but in the desert you can really get thirsty fast. But we saw that last week their complaining and their murmuring had turned into something different. They left it unchecked. They continued to complain and murmur, but it evolved into contending. And basically contending is a more violent version of murmuring. They were starting to threaten Moses as well. And what they were doing is they were taking all of their anger, all of their problems, all of their trials out on Moses. But the question I had for you was, are they really mad at Moses? Are they mad at Moses? No, because they're actually really mad at God, but they're putting it on one person, and we often do that in our life. And they say these words to Moses. They say, is the Lord among us or not? You know, we are the ones that are looking into this story going, how can you possibly ever say, is the Lord among us or not? We watched you be delivered time and time again. We watched plagues and miracles and the sea was split. How could you ever say, is the Lord among us? But it's so funny because we sit on this side of things and asking them how they could say that. But how often in our life, when things aren't going the way that we think they should, that we forget about the miracles of yesterday? That we forget about all the things that the Lord has pulled us out, all the provision that He has given us, all the relationships and blessing in our life. And that is a good way to keep your eyes focused on the right thing, is focused on what the Lord has given you and what the Lord has done, and it will strengthen you. And as we begin to forget that in our lives, it's one of the scariest spots that you can be in. And we saw that Moses went to these extremes. He went and he's like, what are you even talking about? Why are you getting mad at me? And he went to the Lord and he literally says this: what shall I do with this people, Lord? This people that you told me to lead, this it hasn't been easy for Moses, has it? this has been far from easy. And he goes, what did you have me do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me. You know, everyone wants to be a leader. Everyone wants to be a pastor. When we ask CBI, who here thinks that you have the gift of leadership? About every single one of them will raise their hand. And then you go, who thinks that you're gonna be a pastor or a senior pastor? At least half of them raise their hand. And everyone wants to do that until you get to experience what it's like to lead people. You're much like Moses half the time in your ministry. Lord, why do these people want to stone me? Why are these people coming against me? And because Jesus said, listen, if you love me, feed my sheep, tend to my sheep. But like I mentioned, a lot of those sheep are sheep that bite. A lot of those sheep are sheep that are stubborn and they want to do what they want and they go and they walk out in the world and they come back all beat up and there's thorns and thickets and you're constantly pulling this out of them. And that's when true leadership is really tried. And what do you do in that? And so God gave Moses this plan because God knew to go to Moses with the problem. I mean, Moses knew to go to God with the problems. And God gave Moses the plan to strike the rock in Horeb and water would come out of it. Another miracle that God did. But we have to know something, that Jesus was that rock that was struck. It was a beautiful picture. Jesus was that rock that was struck for our sin. That Jesus was the rock that was struck that we could have that water of life flowing out of us abundantly through his sacrifice and his resurrection. Jesus is the one that fills us up to overflowing, and no amount of dirty streams or bitter waters that you drink from in this world will ever satisfy you. The thing that every single person has looked for and every person in this book have looked for is Jesus Christ, and he's free for you tonight. And we're gonna give you a chance to accept that at the end of this message. But let's go ahead and start with chapter 17, verse 8 through 16. It says here, now Amalek came and fought with Israel in Rephidim. That's verse 8 of chapter 17. Now we're in verse 9. And Moses said to Joshua, choose us some men and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. So Joshua did as Moses said to him and fought with Amalek, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And so it was when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed, and when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands became heavy. So they took a stone and they put it under him and he sat on it. And Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side and one on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. So Joshua defeated Amalek, his people, with the edge of the sword. Then the Lord said to Moses, write this for a memorial in the book and recount it in the hearing of Joshua, that I will utterly blot out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. And Moses built an altar and called its name, the Lord is my banner. For he said, because the Lord has sworn, the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you so much that we are gathered here. Lord, we are so thankful that we are able to just come before you with the Holy Spirit, Lord, and you can minister to us and you can teach your children, Lord. Lord, that's what we pray. We pray that you tonight would teach us by the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, we don't want any flesh in this message. We don't want any other spirit in this message. Lord, we only want you. Father, we're hungry for you. And so, Lord, we just pray that you would do a great thing in this room tonight. Lord, that your word would just be applicable to our lives and it would just be easy to settle in and it would fall on good soil, Lord. Lord, lives would be changed. Father, I thank you personally for the lives that have been changed on Wednesday nights. Lord, just simply through reading the truth of the word of God. And Lord, if there's anything amazing, anything good in this word, Lord God, anything that was great in worship, Lord, it all just reflects how great you are. And so, Lord, we love you and thank you in Jesus' name, amen. Now let's look at verse 8 together as we just continue on through our study. It says, so now Amalek came and fought with Israel in Rephidim. Does this just, I mean, to you, does this just kind of come out of nowhere as well? I mean, we ended up with them talking about being thirsty, and then they struck a rock, and it ended with, because they tempted the Lord, saying, is the Lord among us or not? And then right after it goes, now Amalek came and fought with Israel in Rephidim. We're like, did we skip a page? Like, what? Who are these people? What just happened? And why is there attacking going on? I can't say it enough, and I shared it at the beginning, but the road that you follow with the Lord is very rarely the easiest road that you can be on. In fact, it's quite the opposite. But time and time again, there is a common denominator in whatever problem that is being faced. The common denominator is if you trust in the Lord, God will deliver you from those problems. Do you believe that in here tonight, church? And are we all awake? We all say amen. Yes. Amen. God provides protection for his people when they cry out. In life, I encourage you personally not to look for the easy way all the time. Instead, I want to encourage you to look for his way in your life. That's when you'll get the most ground. That's when you'll be doing things that are outside of your comfort zone, and the Lord will have to show up. It's an amazing spot to be in, but it's a scary spot to be in. So let us meet the Amalekites. So we see them, they're basically descendants of Esau, who we read about in Genesis. They were a nomadic tribe, so they didn't really stay too much in one location. They went around a lot. They traveled around the region. They were brutal people. They were brutal people, and the way they made their living was looting and pillaging as a way to provide. These people were murderers and killers, and they were not the kind of people you would want to run into while walking around the desert after being freed from slavery. This would be like the last thing that you'd want to happen. Honestly, I don't know what they look like, but I always picture in my head what they look like. You can picture them however you want, because we don't really know what they look like, but I'm gonna picture them like this, right? I watch shows like Viking shows and stuff where they come and they come in on the boats and they have like the funny hats and they have hatchets and stuff. That's what I'm picturing. I could be 100% wrong, but I'm taking that and like if Mad Max and like Vikings had a baby, this is what it would be in my mind. It's probably wrong. It probably is, but that's okay. That's what's going on in my mind. So these people were brutal. These people killed, these people looted, these people pillaged. That's how they made their money. And the fight seemed to come out of nowhere. Okay, we just got some water. Now Amalek came and fought with Israel. It's like, wait a second. These people came against God's people for no reason, it seems, except to be horrible people like the Amalekites were. They were just doing what they've always done, and that's destroying other people's lives. I want you to know something. They were only there to disrupt what God was doing in the children of Israel. But I want you to know something, as greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. I believe that with everything inside of me. Can I also say this? Don't try to make sense of why you are being attacked. In my life, I've been attacked for no reason. Pastor Gerald has been attacked time and time and time again as well for times that I'm trying to figure out, why would you even say that? Why would you even do that? And if you try to figure it out in your own mind, you will go crazy, because most of the time these attacks are coming, they're spiritual and they're being done for a reason that is frankly demonic. And so these people that are attacking God's people, that's exactly why it's happening. And Moses said to Joshua in verse 9, "Choose us some men and go out and fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand." That's the second time we've heard it called rod of God, but I think it's a pretty good name for it, right? It's the rod that God continually used that was in his hand. And we get to meet one of Moses' closest friends, the person that Moses is going to raise up in ministry, the person that's going to be right next to him and assist him. We meet Joshua here. And what is Joshua already doing? Joshua is already coming beside Moses and being a help and learning and growing in whatever capacity that he could possibly learn and grow in. It's coming from a time in the future where he's going to, unbeknownst to him, actually lead the children of Israel into that promised land. And if you want to know the best way it is to grow, and this is the one reason I love CBI and the leadership behind it, because we know that the greatest way to actually learn leadership, or the greatest way to do things for the Lord, if you're gonna go to a Bible college, is not to puff yourself up with knowledge, which we have some of the greatest teachers, in my opinion, teaching the word, but I will tell you, it's It's coming alongside and learning how other people did things in ministry and life. Every single event here we do at the church, I try to tell the CBI students that learn from this. We're going to do an event here. Learn how we do this. We're going to do a high school event. Learn how they did this. Learn everything, because so much of ministry is caught, not taught. You just come in and you be about the business. You be about the battle. You do what the Lord has called you to do. And one beautiful thing, I think it's awesome, as you're going to see CBI graduate up here on Friday night, right? That so many of them are gonna tell you on where they're going. Here's where I'm going to go teach. Here's where I'm going to go do. This is what I'm going to, where I'm going to intern. Because that year that they're here, it's awesome, because they learn and they grow and they have practical ministry where they have to work, and there's just a lot going on. But the greatest spot, in my opinion, is afterwards, where they go back to. A lot of them are going to a church that needs other pastors. A lot of them are going to churches where the pastor just wants young people in the church to revive that church. There's a lot of different people going in a lot of different spots. So you get to work on that Paul and Timothy relationship. You get to continue to work one-on-one with a pastor as you guys are in the battle together. Maybe you're the only two people on staff, who knows? But you can have that Moses and Joshua leadership and mentorship as they witness how pastors deal with everyday problems, as they get to see how they deal with the major problems. One thing I thought was great was last year, Gerald actually had a meeting with the city. And Gerald said, let's bring all of CBI to see how I do this. And at that point, I'm like, oh Lord, if I ever have to do this, I'm going to be terrified, but at least I'll be somewhat equipped, because I've seen the way Pastor Gerald has done this. We get to see how pastors walk it out in faith, and very little of who I am in my ministry today is because Gerald sat me down in my office for 8 hours and said, let us open our words, yay. First Chronicles says, no, all of it's been like, hey, we're going somewhere, jump in the car. Okay, oh yeah, absolutely. Okay, you need to go do this. I can't do it. Yes, you can go. So much of that is the exact what you're seeing here. There is a battle taking place. Moses says, Joshua, you need to go out there and fight. You need to go. And that's an important aspect of anyone that wants to be a pastor, is learning how to delegate leadership. Learning how to not try to do everything on your own, or you will be exhausted before you even make it to the front line of the battle. It is a must for a pastor to find other people that are gifted and talented and allow them to grow in that ministry. That's exactly what happened here, and allowed Moses to do what he needed to do. And what was Moses? What did he need to do? He said this. He says that I will stand on the top of the hill, and I will have the rod of God in my hand. Catchy name, Moses, I love it. The rod of God he will have in his hand. Everyone in this battle had a role. That is how it goes. Every single person that was there, there was a role to be done. Some of them were up with the rod of God, some were actually in the war. Do you see what an act of faith it is to send someone like Joshua into the middle of the war? But I'll tell you, Moses knew that he couldn't win this battle. He knew that apart from the Lord, there was no way he was going to win this battle. Even if Joshua was a great general, there's no way that Joshua was going to lead the children of Israel to beat the Amalekites if they weren't going to go to the Lord first. And so he knew he had to go to the Lord, because victory, church, rests in the hands of God. God used this rod of God, this act of faith, again, allowing him to have something in his life that was tangible, that says, I will take care of you. Hold up the rod of God in your hand. And he did so. He held the rod of God. Listen, holding on to past victories that you've had with God, keeping God in clear view, is how you will win the present battles in your life. Hebrews 13:5 says this, for he himself has said, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. So we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear, for what can man do to me? If God was there through the troubles of slavery, if God was there in the plagues, if he was there in the darkness, if he was there in the blistering heat of the desert, if he was there when their backs were against the sea, if he was there when the bitter waters were made sweet, if he was there in the hunger and the thirst that they had continually, then surely God would be there in this present battle in their life. Remind yourself that God has never left you. Never left you. Sorry, I don't know what I'm talking about. God has never left you. God has never forsaken you. And God loves you. Look at verses 10 through 11. So Joshua did as Moses said. And for me, I'm an assistant pastor, so I underlined that in my Bible twice. So Joshua did as Moses said to him and fought with Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And so it was when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. Man, it is so important to be a man of your word. It is so important. That's why I underlined it in my Bible. Joshua did as Moses said, because can you imagine the story if Joshua said, yeah, I'll go out there and I will start to battle. But then he was like, nah, I'm not gonna do that. It would leave Moses from going up on the hill and praying and going before the Lord to scramble and find someone else that would carry the torch and run into battle. It is important to be a man of your word and to do what you say you're going to do. There was no fighting or arguing on behalf of Joshua to Moses. He didn't sit there and go, well, I have to go down there and risk my life as he's gonna sit up there and hold his hand up. You know, I have to go down there and fight when he gets to go up in the hill away from the battle. No, he understood to win this battle that people had roles into doing the victory of the Lord. We all have that role. There could be no schism. There could be no contention. And if there is, the whole structure begins to fall apart. When someone begins to look at someone else in ministry and they don't like the job that they have, and they go, well, I'm working harder than that person in my life, then every day you show up and you resent them, and really who you're resenting is the Lord. Think about it. I should be the one on the hill. I'm the spiritual one. Yeah, no, God's showing you that you are most definitely not if that's who you think you are. Instead, Joshua chose to believe Moses. God had worked through Moses time and time and time and time again. Surely he would do it again. And Moses knew he could rely on him, and he did. Moses was raising up Joshua by allowing him to be part of the battle. There are pastors all over the world that are terrified to allow their assistant pastors to be part of the battle. That I get to teach on Sunday and Wednesday nights, there are pastors that never let their other pastors teach any other service but themselves because they're scared of their own assistant pastors. Let this be a huge reminder to you, assistant pastor, someday, to let your senior pastor lead. It is not your job to usurp him. It is not your job to try to throw him over and try to take the people with you. It's actually kind of amazing. Because you see what's happening is Joshua's out there fighting, and Moses could see a whole different point of view. Moses could see that every time his hands were up and his hands, as he was putting it, this battle into the Lord's hands, there was victory. But the minute he started to go like this because his hand was tired, all of a sudden he watched his people get destroyed. And so everything within him was to keep his hand up and to focus on what the Lord was doing with the rod of God. Wouldn't that just be amazing to see things through the lens in which Moses saw? I mean, think about that. That when we raise our hands and put the victory into God's hands, and when we cease to worship and we cease to trust him, that we begin to lose ground. If we could view it that way, every single one of us would be like, Lord, all the time, it's all you. It's all you, Lord. We would never stop praising the Lord with our hands up. But the thing is, we don't see it like that. We're often blinded by our own comforts. We're often blinded by other things. And so we don't see it like Moses saw it all the time. But church, there is great victory when you surrender your battle. There's a lot of different reasons why people raise their hands during worship. Some of them say it's because it says, you know, it's like you're like, pick me up, Dad, Abba, Father, you know, you're raising your hands. You know, a lot of it's because there's victory in raising your hands to the Lord and putting whatever problem, whatever situation, whatever is hindering you onto his plate and just surrendering it. And when your hands are up, there's victory. That's the truth. As your hands are up and you're focused on that and you're focusing on praise, that your salvation is secure, other things seem to kind of go away. Here's something that you can 100% rest in. Romans 8, 35 through 39. You can focus on this. You can hold this up. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation? Shall distress? Shall persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or a sword? For as it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. When you begin to struggle, I pray you can surrender that to the Lord. Whatever's going on in my life right now, I'm going to raise my hand and I'm going to praise the Lord that nothing can separate me from the love of God. We need to be a people, whenever we go to any sort of battle or to any sort of problem in our life, that we raise our hands, count on the Lord for his strength and his power, and remind ourselves of the word of God. Look at verses 12 through 13. But Moses' hands became heavy, so they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. And Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side and one on the other. On the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. So Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. So these two noticed that Moses' hands were heavy. I mean, this would be a hard thing to do. Like, I had a really bad idea, which I'm not doing right now, but for us to all start the service by raising our hand and see how long we could hold it, right? Because all of us would be tired, and some of the young people would be the first ones to give up. This is dumb. I'm putting my hand down. Right? In fact, I think it'd be the older people that, I'll show these young kids, I'll hold this hand up all day. But that would be hard to do with this rod in your hand, to continually keep your hands up to the Lord. And so Moses and Aaron and Hur begin to see too what's going on, and every time his hands would go down, they would begin to lose. And so without being asked, they did something amazing. Moses didn't say, can't you see? My hands are tired and my legs are weak. I am an old man. Get me a rock. I need to sit down. I'm the one in charge. What happened is they just wanted to be the people that blessed Moses. They knew where their victory lied, and they began to want to take initiative to bless the leadership that was in their life that needed comfort. Young people who get the opportunity to serve, remember that. Let your heart be one for leaders and pastors in your life, that you want to comfort them, that you want to carry on initiative, that you want to make the ministry in which you go to better. You don't want to just go there. You want to go there and make it better. But too often do we see this in our lives. And I shared that there's so many, with delegation, there's so many pastors that are scared to let their assistant pastor teach, because what they're afraid of is when their arms get tired, when they're having a time of their life that is difficult, that person right next to them, instead of holding their arms up so they can continue the leadership of the people, to grab them a chair that they may be able to sit on. What they're afraid of is that means if they're too tired to hold up their arms, that it is time for me to take over without being told to do so. I've seen it enough times in my life in churches, and honestly, there's only one thing that is, and that is you are being used by the enemy to destroy the church from the inside. That's all it is. That's all it is. I'm sorry that it's coming off so harshly, but I want every person to hear that. Whether you're a church goer and you begin to hear an assistant pastor hurting people and talking bad about the pastor, that you will see that. Or whether you are an assistant pastor yourself and you begin to think good about yourself, about the good reports that are coming back when you hear that, oh, you're such a great teacher. You're way better than that guy. You're right, I am pretty fantastic, you know? It doesn't matter your age. But man, I picture anyone holding up their arms. I began to picture myself when I was a young kid. Have you ever tried to hold up your arm for a long time? And like I said, I had the idea for all of us to hold up our hands. But I was the kid that like always wanted to talk in class, go figure. But I would oftentimes raise my hand and I would never put it down just to be obnoxious. And so I would do like the elbow support technique. You guys ever read this one? And then it became like, she's going to see me. And she never said this. She never said like, BJ, put your hand down. She just let me do it. And I'm like, I will not break. I did the elbow support technique with the headrest, right? Think about that. But your arm gets tired, right? And if I wasn't so stubborn, I would have put it down a long time ago. But there was great victory being won when his arms were up and other people, you know, probably didn't even recognize what was going on. Everyone was too busy going out there and battling to realize that the real battle was being won in prayer through the leadership of their congregation. Through Moses' submission to the Lord, that's how the battle was truly being won. And in this chapter, I love Aaron and Hur, and I can learn so much from them. The way that Moses had a younger Joshua to go and attend to the battle at hand, but God had actually put Aaron and Hur right next to him to hold up his hands. They went up right next to him, and he didn't even have to tell him what to do, and they just did it. God does these things so organically. God will put people in your life that just know your next move when he begins to raise you up. God provided these people in this ministry in right now of what they're doing just to take care of them. But I think about my own life and I think about Pastor Gerald's life. And it's a blessing to be able to assist him. And a lot of times I have to remind myself as he hands me things and I'm like, that's not my department, that I go, I'm here to assist him. Because that's where the Holy Spirit has placed me. And me being here in the position I'm in, I'm telling you, church, God is the only person that could write that story. But I think about Pastor Fem. Pastor Fem is right next to Gerald, and he's another person that continues to hold up his hands. But I will tell you that in any capacity of ministry, God puts those people in your life if you're leading. God has put those people in my life. Pastor Adam is one that continually looks on how he can hold up my hands or how can I pray for you. And there's a lot of different ways to do it. Chad Milson is another one. But God will put these people in your life next to you in ministry to do things like hold up your hands, but it's to offer wisdom. There's another way. To pray for you, to give you advice, to help bear some of the brunt of the drama that comes from being in ministry, to jump into the fire with you. Where are we going? I'm going with you. You're not gonna stand by yourself while everyone else wants to stay home and be comfortable. I will jump into the fire with you. Or maybe it is just holding their hands up in praise when times get rough. Look at verses 13 through 16 as we wrap this up. So Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. That's amazing. Then the Lord said to Moses, write this for a memorial in the book and recount it in the hearing of Joshua that I will utterly blot out of remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. And Moses built an altar and called its name, the Lord is my banner. For he said, because the Lord has sworn, the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. You want to know why God was so brutal with Amalek? Because he took it very personally that they went against his people. I do not want to be on the other side of going against God's people. Amalek, man, they thought that this would be easy pickings. Here's these people wandering around out in the desert. We're going to go destroy them. We're trained warriors, and yet they did not take into account the God in which they served. Because Joshua defeated Amalek. Do you believe that tonight there's great victory in the Lord? Then we need to start acting like it. If we truly believe that there's great victory in the Lord, then we should be the ones looking to how we could get involved. How can I get involved? How can I serve at this church? How can I help? Listen, Joshua defeated Amalek, but church, we know that really who defeated Amalek, it was God. Your victory is not in a person. Your victory is not in Pastor Gerald. Your victory is not in myself. And quite frankly, we don't want you to ever think of us more than pastor teacher to you. There's a lot of people that helped build this church. There's a lot of people that helped in this ministry. There's a lot of people from day one that made this a possibility because it is an army moving forward with the Lord and the one that deserves every amount of the credit. That's why I started this service with saying, if you saw anything good in anyone in this room today, it has nothing to do with who we are. We are sinners. But Jesus Christ is so good that if you saw anything beautiful with someone saying hi to you as they walked in, offering you hand sanitizer, visiting you in the hospital, greeting you, teaching you, whatever it is the Lord and the Lord alone that receives the glory. And this altar that was built would be a memory of that. As the worship team comes back up, this altar would be a memory of that. That whoever sees it, they would know that the true God fights for Israel. It was almost, honestly, guys, it was almost like a prideful, like, just so you know, our God's the one true God. We should have been destroyed, but the Lord is my banner. A statement to anyone and everyone that God is in charge of his people and church. We need to walk with that certainty. Just so you know, I know what the world says, but I'm going to walk forward with the Lord, and just so you know, he's the only true God. And Moses gave the appropriate credit to the Lord. And I encourage everyone in here, if anyone notices that there's something different about you, give that appropriate credit to the Lord. He didn't begin to campaign for himself a better job or more, more people to do things for him or anything like that. Instead, he just said, let's build an altar to the Lord, because it was God that defeated the Amalekites. We're gonna dim the lights. But church, my heart for everyone in here tonight is number one, to be saved. I find more about myself when I'm teaching that I'm very much an evangelist, because my heart before it even equipping and sending is to see you guys come to know Jesus, because it's so important. And a lot of what I'm saying is going to be completely confusing to you if you've never had a personal relationship. It doesn't mean you went to church when you were young. It doesn't mean that your grandma's a Christian. It doesn't mean that your father was a Christian. It doesn't mean anything. It means who you are today with Christ. And only you and the Lord knows that. So always my heart is that you would know the Lord. So church, I'm gonna give every person a chance to know the Lord in here tonight. And I'm just going to ask. And I'm going to just ask everyone, we're gonna do the heads bowed. I feel like we should do this, heads bowed, eyes closed. And if someone wants to just either give their heart to the Lord for the first time tonight or recommit their heart to the Lord, if you wanna see that victory, I would encourage you just to raise your hand tonight. Amen, 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 amen. So church, what we're gonna do is we're just gonna repeat after them. We're just gonna repeat after me, everyone together, because we're all brothers and sisters in Christ. And so would you just repeat after me, Lord Jesus, I do believe that you are my victory. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sin and taking my place. Take away all my sin, Lord. Thank you for raising from the dead. Fill me full of your Holy Spirit. Let me live for you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Now church, this is for everyone. For those that just said that prayer, for those that have walked with the Lord for a long time, for those that know a little about the Lord, or those that are mature oaks that have been growing by the stream for a long time, I encourage you tonight to keep your eyes focused on him. Keep your hands lifted in praise to God and trust him for the victory. Can I just encourage you as well to pray for your leadership? Can I just encourage you to come beside the leaders of the church as they make decisions in this world, in this climate? If anyone envies that job, they don't understand what it means. The whole world is beginning to say what is wrong is right and what is right is wrong. And church, you need to stand beside your leaders of the church in support. But oh, how quickly we do the opposite and we get mad when they don't remember our name. Or we get mad when they didn't put out the right kind of cookies. Or we get mad at all the comforts of American church that it can offer. And we complain and we bicker and we cause division. Instead, check your own heart. Say, Lord, cleanse me of that kind of stuff, because I just want to be one that is in the battle, trusting in you for the victory, holding up our leaders, all of us working together for the common goal, and that is to make Jesus Christ known and famous for what he has done in our life. Church, the battle is outside of these doors. We're pretty safe in here, realistically. But I will tell you, if he can't reach us from the outside, he's gonna reach us from the inside. So we gotta watch how we're treating each other. But church, the battle is out there. There is people that are desperate to hear the gospel message of the world. The world is so desperate to hear the gospel message that Jesus Christ died on the cross and that he loves them and that they're worth something more than any race, more than male or female or this or that. It's 100% loving people in the name of Jesus in a very wicked time. And so I'm gonna pray one more prayer, and we're gonna be outside praying. If you'd like to pray with us, we'd encourage you to come outside. It's beautiful out there. But I'm gonna pray for us as a church, and then we're gonna close. Lord, I just thank you so much for this time, Father, and Lord, as we have just heard this message, Lord God, about battles, Lord, and it comes out of nowhere. Lord, maybe tonight there's battles being fought in this room with family members. Maybe tonight the battles that have come, Lord, came out of nowhere. But Lord, I pray that we would never forget about the victory that we have had in you for years. The victory in you that is so great. And Lord, I pray that we would not be swayed to the left or to the right. Lord, we wouldn't first be identified by our political party, but Lord, we would be identified as followers of Christ, and that would be the thing that people recognize. Lord Jesus, fill us anew and afresh, we pray. And Lord God, let the world see truly what a small group of people can do when they're filled with the Holy Spirit and their hands are raised to you. Lord, we pray that you would use us in greater ways than our own capacity. And we just love you and we honor you and we respect you. And Lord, we trust you with your will for our lives, not our own. Lord Jesus, come. And Lord, as I'm praying this, if you believe that in your own heart, just say, Lord, your will, not mine. And just repeat it through this worship. Lord, your will for my life, not my own. Your plan for my life, not my own. Lord, I just want to be an obedient servant. And so, Father, I pray you would continue to teach me that, because I'm definitely not there yet. Break me of things and pride and stupidity. But Lord, I have a heart that wants to follow. And so, Lord, I pray that you would see that and be pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen.